Can people hear me without having their ears blown off?
No? No? Okay.
Okay, I've successfully fought with the VG adapter, and now everything works. Can people see the screen? Oh, what? Oh, just increase the text size? Okay. Is that better? Okay. So hi, I'm Yuvi. I work in the Wikimedia Labs team, and I hack on things on the side. This used to be one of those things. So this is a system called PAWS, P-A-W-S. The original problem that I was trying to solve is, do people here know of PyWikiBot? Right? It's a bot framework that you know, like, has a lot of utilities. You can, if you want to replace, you know, 5,000 instances of in with off, it lets you do that, and also other more useful things. But one big problem with it is that you had to download and install it yourself. You have to download it to your computer, and if you had Windows, then you're mostly screwed, because then, you know, like 3 days later, you're like, I could have just hand done those 500 replacements, and it would have been faster. This is also a problem on, so Labs has a PyWikiBot set up, so it's slightly easier, but it was still problematic because you had to first then understand how SSH works, how private keys work, and how to use the grid engine system in tool labs, and like all of these things that are completely unrelated to what you were originally trying to do, which was to make these edits. So we started, like, I started hacking on a system that allows you to use a terminal from just the browser. So that's how this came up. You can try this out now. You can go to paws.wmflabs.org, paws.wmflabs.org. So this started out as just for making bots, but it's basically metasized into something much more useful and much more powerful. So I'll basically go through a quick demo of the different things that you can do with this, and also some things that you can do maybe in like a couple of weeks, but I can do in my account now. And then we'll just talk about it. And I also encourage you all to try it out on your browsers as well. And just scream at me if something goes wrong. I can probably fix that here. This is also all beta software. Everything is new. Everything might break at any point of time. And if it does, tell me, and I will hopefully fix it. OK, so this, you sign in with OAuth, which means that if you just have a Wiki account, it works for you. So I'm going to sign in. So this is going to ask for all of these rights. And that might be a bit scary, but I will, once I grant it, I will explain to you why this is going on. Yes, someone has a question? Yes, if you have a bot account, log in with your bot account. That will also become clear soon. So I'm going to click allow. OK, so you would usually just see my server as the button if you're logging in for the first time. And if you click it, it might take a few seconds. But it will spin up a new container just for you with a lot of useful utilities installed. Okay, so this is the screen you would see once you log in. It won't have all those files. Those are just things I've created after a while. But let me just show a quick demo of the terminal, and then I'll come back to the files. So if you go to New and click Terminal, so this will give you a terminal. Boom. Yay. OK. Yeah, so this is a terminal. This is a full-fledged terminal, not very different from what you would get with SSH. You can run Emacs in it. You can run Vim in it. You can run text mode web browsers in it. But you can also just run any bash scripts. You can run Python files, whatever. And the reason that the OAuth asked for so many permissions is because that is directly passed into this now. So you don't need to use your bot password or anything here. You are already logged in. So if I do pwb.pylogin, it will tell me that I'm logged in onto the Tamil Wikipedia, which is where I was editing, as Yuvi Panda. So that is why the OAuth asks for all these permissions, because then it can make these, you know, you can do bot edits as you. It doesn't ask for any permissions that are admin only for security reasons, because if you're doing admin stuff, yeah, you have to jump through a few more hoops. And you know, there's a URL there with the documentation, so you can, like, I've set it to work on Tamil Wikipedia, but of course you can make it use like whatever wiki family you want and do bot edits. And the most important thing about this entire experience is it was less than a minute to get to this place, right? While if you were using PyWikiBot in a different environment, it would take you a much longer time, and it would be much more frustrating. At this point, you can now think of what are the edits I want to make, and how do I make them with PyWikiBot? You're only thinking of the actual essential problem you're trying to solve, and most of the surrounding bullshit has been kind of like taken away that most people don't have to care about. So this was the original thing. So the PAWS originally stand for PyWikiBot, a web shell, but then we realized you can do a lot more things with it, so we just called it PAWS, a web shell, so it became recursive. So any thoughts and questions so far? So this is just the, you know, like I just have a PyWikiBot thing I want to run use case, which is very simple, works very well. There are some negative aspects. The terminal is a JavaScript terminal. It, like, you know, Vim works, Emacs works, but copy paste doesn't work yet. People are fixing it. It's taking a while because JavaScript is terrible, but also awesome. But yeah, and you can't enter non-Latin characters into it yet. I'll show a workaround for it later. But any questions, thoughts, comments, asking me to go away? Yes. It works. Yeah, if things don't work for people, please put up your hand. I'll come around afterwards and fix things. Like, this is all very, very new. It's running on top of new technology in labs. It's running on top of Kubernetes. And, like, it's just bonkers. Yeah. OK. Did you ask something? Right, yeah, so this is a PyWikiBot bug where by default it is set to TestWiki. So if your bot has never logged into TestWiki, it will freak out and die. So the way you can switch wikis is, if I click the Jupyter button, it just takes me back to home. So this is a file browser, and you can edit files in here. So one of the files is userconfig.py, there's userconfig.py. So if I click it, it opens in a nice text editor where I can edit stuff. And I've just set mylang equal to TA. So if you create user-config.py and set mylang equals to whatever you want, and then log in again, it will work. So when you get on the terminal, there is a link on the top which has a link to the PyWikiBot manual that is specific to PAWS, and that has this information and a bunch of other differences between running PyWikiBot on your computer and running it here. Yes? So it's empty for you because you just logged in. There is nothing there. It's your home directory. You haven't put anything in here, so it's empty. Yeah, it's you have to create it. By default, it defaults to TestWiki. You have to create the file. And under new, there is a terminal, but you can also just click, new file, and then create a file. By default, it'll be called untitled1.txt, because Notepad, I guess, I don't know. But you can click the file name and change it to whatever you want. Right, so this is the second feature. You have a text editor that you can use to edit text. This is important, I think, because honestly, like if you are not used to it, Vim and Emacs and Nano, and they all suck. You didn't want to learn how to do text editing on a console. You wanted to type something and go on with your life. So that's another reason I really like this. So the terminal, what you see, is the same as the home directory here. So if I go back to the terminal and do ls, I will get the same thing you see there. So that's just the graphical representation of what you see here. So anytime for any application or configuration or a text file, or any kind of file, you can always just use the text editor rather than going through the command line. But of course, you can also use the command line if that's what you want to do. Is that OK so far? Yeah, so the workaround for not being able to copy paste into the terminal is you paste into the text editor and then execute that file. It's a terrible workaround, but it's better than not being able to copy paste. So I just copy paste my file into a bash file, and then in the terminal just run bash name a file, and that executes. And that works around both the copy-paste problem and cannot type non-Latin characters into the terminal problem. Okay, so these are like useful things, but I think the coolest part is the next stuff. Do people know of IPython notebooks? Okay, some people know. Okay, so do people know of REPLs? Read, eval, print loops. So it's a very interactive form of writing code. While traditionally you would sit, write a file, and then tab to a terminal, and then run it, and then see what happened, come back, and then change it, go back, run it, come back, change it. Or you might have an IDE where the workflow is kind of very similar, but you have a run button that runs it for you. But in the end, you are context switching between running, and then the run is complete, right? Like if you want to like go and add one line there, you're adding it and then rerunning it. This is how most of it is done. Of course, like there's precedence for other things, but this is how most programs are written. But there is also the old tradition of REPLs. Like if you started learning Python, you would probably type Python on the command line, and it would basically give you this thing where you can type something, press enter, it'll evaluate it, and bring it back for you. But writing large programs this way has always been quite painful because you can't go up and edit very easily, you can't just change something, and it's also hard to share. So notebooks were started many, many years ago in the academic community for people who wanted to share. They liked using REPL for their exploratory analysis because they were like, I have this data and I want to play around with it to see how it's like. But I don't want to use REPL because text mode and I can't see my graphs. So this was started maybe 10 years ago as an easy way for academics to explore the data sets and share it with other people in a reproducible fashion. But then they kept it to themselves. And I mean, it's open source, but it was not very popular outside of the academic community for many, many years. In the last few years, that's changed. It's being used in a lot more places, companies for analysis and whatnot. But so this is just an install of IPython notebooks, basically. I'll just show you a very simple demo of what it can do. So you can use that with many languages. We have support for Python 3, R, and Bash. I will add support for Node.js and PHP at some point. So let's start a Python 1. Right, so this is a coding environment. You can write arbitrary code here, and it'll execute. So right, so that's just like hello world, you just run it. So this is the same advantages for the PyWikiBot case, which is you didn't have to download anything, you didn't have to set it up, you didn't have to figure out an editor, you didn't have to figure out how to compile stuff. You just typed it out and hit shift enter and it runs. And you can do arbitrarily complex things with it. You are not just restricted to doing simple stuff like this. So you can, as output, have HTML elements. So you can have an interactive map be the output of your Python function. Or you can have, like a 3D plot that people can explore as the output. Or this is my most favorite one. Right. There's also autocomplete, so I can just tab and it will complete for me. I can do that again. Oops, wrong. So that's a simple function, right? I'm just calling it. I'm giving it input by also just like manually calling this. This is a very common use case, and it would be nice if there's a graphical interface to do this. So you can do that with notebooks. Right, so that just popped up a text box and a button. So I can just type stuff into it, and then it'll just run. Right, so this is the equivalent, right? Like you can call the function directly or you can put it into a text box and then make that happen. And so these are called widgets. And this is powerful because this widget is running in JavaScript on the client side. So you can do interactive stuff with it. But the actual code is Python. So if you wanted to do this normally, you would have had to learn how JavaScript works, how to make widgets work on the client side, how to communicate them to the server, bring the results back, and display that for you. Which is great if you want to build a full-fledged application, but if you just want to go, oh, but I just wanted to, you know, not have to type this all the time, then that's too much, right? So you can do this. And you can also build custom widgets. One of the widgets I'm going to build is, for example, it auto-completes wiki names, because that's a very common thing to do when you want to run wikis. You want to be like, okay, I want to make a list of wikis. So you can just have something that auto-completes and produces a list of wikis and also does validation and all of those things. And the useful thing here is it's, I'm going to say something stupid. It's somewhat similar to wiki text, but without all the stupid shit, in that one person can build something that other people can use very much. You can already do that. Like, I could do something like that with by building a Python library and sending it to PyPy. But that then requires that everyone knows how to use it, which is great if you're a programmer, but not great if you just want to do something. One of the underlying philosophies behind this is, like, in the Middle Ages, there used to be this group of people called scribes. They were very, very important and whatnot because they could read and write. And that was a very useful skill that not many people had. And, you know, if you wanted to do something, you would go to a scribe, and then they would charge you a lot of money, treat you like shit, and then they would write the stuff for you. Maybe not the treat you like shit part, but programming right now is not very dissimilar. In the same way how everyone now, of course, you'll need to learn to read and write. I think, like, programming in the long term, maybe in 100 years, in 200 years, would be like, oh yeah, of course, I can program my TV, and sure, I can do this in the computer as well. So that's like the long term. There's a lot of, the academics have done a lot of stuff around this. They call it end user programming and a bunch of other buzzwords and wrote a lot of papers and put them behind $400 paywalls, so it's actually not useful to anyone. But yeah, so this is a lot of bringing that down here. So yeah, so that's the interactive stuff. This is just like the most simplest thing. You can have sliders, you can have list boxes. It's just like any arbitrary JavaScript. Another thing. Okay, let me also show you one more thing that I've been working on, which is a demo, which is this. So do people here know of Wikimetrics? Vaguely, kind of? Okay, people here know of edit counters? Yeah, okay, so edit counters is basically you give someone a username, and it gives you back all the thing, just the count of edits they've made. And sometimes, like, you just, like, so this is a simple demo, which is proving multiple concepts. One is how, I'll scroll this. Let me hide all the top things so there's more space. Okay, let's get rid of this. Yeah, that's better. Okay, so what I really want to show here is this workflow, which is I have a thing I want to do, but I want other people to also be able to do it. I want to make myself obsolete. Right? So right now, that means you have to write a tool or something and maintain it. But let's take the very, very simple case where I have this SQL query I want to run. Right? Very simple SQL query. In this case, it's just number of edits in a given set of namespaces for a given set of users in a given set of wikis. And that is if you know SQL, it's not particularly difficult to do. But then you have to know SQL. And then you also have to write all the surrounding code for it. So this is, like, if you look at it, like, I'll explain the top bits later, but this is just a small function which takes, list of users, start date, end date, and what databases you want to run it on as a parameter, and then just, like, writes the SQL. If you look inside, the SQL is parameterized, so this is, like, colon namespaces. Inside which will go the list of namespaces that the user provides, and colon user IDs and start and end. So this is all parameterized. You don't put actual data in there. And then you go down, and then you have this. So this is the interact stuff. This is just calling it, right? So now I can just simply add another username and hit run, and it actually gave me the output. Right? In this case, I'm just printing the dictionary, but of course, I could make it into a pretty HTML display or a table or whatever I want. And I can also run this on more wikis. I can run this on lots of edits on meta, right? Yeah. So this is very nice, I think, because have people used Query? Right, so Query is the thing, it's a web interface where you can go type SQL, hit enter, and it'll run. But it doesn't do parameterization. It just executes SQL. So if I wanted to do the same thing here, I can go find a different query that someone has written on Query, but it'll have the names and the namespaces and everything, so I'll have to know what to look for, how to change it, and if I change it and I forget a quote somewhere, it'll be like, error on line 449, something, something, and then you have to, like, while this is like an actual graphical interface, that's much easier. So this means that you can access the databases from here, right? And you can run arbitrary queries, do arbitrary things with this. And the other important thing here is if you go to the top and look at the first thing, it says from pause.uvpanda.replicahelper import SQL. So what that is doing is like template inclusion, basically, but better, because it's scoped and it works with the default Python stuff. So if I were to do this without pause, the top import, what I would have had to do was I would have made my file, made it into a Python package, properly packaged it, and then uploaded it to PyPy, and then made sure that is updated and whatnot. While in this case, what I did was I had a different, I created a different notebook called replica helper dot IPNB, just like you would create a different template, right? And then I put all the functions I want, and you know, you can also add markdown-based help. So it's self-documenting in many ways, like how you have no include and include only in templates. And these are not imported. These are just for people who are looking at it to see what it does. And it's very nicely documented, not just as code, but you know, with proper, all the stuff that markdown gives you. And then this is just random functions that are imported. So there's an SQL function that I'm importing and using too many tabs here. Okay, yes. Yeah, sure. So if people have written documentation for it, you can very easily do that. Like as a simple, I don't think I wrote documentation for SQL, but even if I don't, if I just type the thing I'm looking for and add a question mark, and then do that, it'll pop this up on the bottom. It lists the parameters and the types, and there is no doc string. So that's where you would put your normal documentation in, which I haven't done. So that's why it doesn't exist. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Usually other packages have pretty good documentation. So if I take, for example, import requests, which is, you know, it's a package for making HTTP requests, and I want to see what it is about. So I do question mark, and it gives me a doc string explaining what it is and some examples, and a lot of other stuff. And I can also make it do individual ones, which also will autocomplete. So I'll type G, and it gave me get, because I'm lazy. And then I type question mark, and then this gives me what all the stuff this is. So yeah, yes. Right. Yes, so Giuseppe's objection to this is that like template vandalism, but a million times worse because it's arbitrary code execution. So the solution, so that is the reason why this is accessible only to my server right now. This is like something that will probably be accessible, like the import stuff is probably something that will be accessible to everyone in maybe a couple of weeks. And I've been working for the last week on versioning, like how you have template versions, and in an ideal world, we could have been able to pin template inclusions to actual versions so that vandalism, at least, well, so that you would lead to a different set of problems than the default set you have. So when that is complete, what you would end up with is something like from pause.user.uvpanda.replicahelper.1.1 import something. And that 1.1 will be immutable. It cannot be changed, at least by the users. Of course, we'll have oversight type functionality so that if something stupid happens, you can call a root, and the root can go change things. And then you also don't have the problem that he was talking about, which is arbitrary code execution, where you know you think it is doing the database, but it is stealing all your data and killing all your users. Yes?
Would one possible solution be having some sort of enforcement or review system where people can basically say, okay, this
Right, yeah. Well, then you'll run into the flagged revisions problem of not enough people doing the imports and stuff. But yeah, I agree. But like step one for all of that is that you need a versioning system. And then you can build social conventions on top of that technical base level setup. The thing we want to do is to have semantic versioning. So you could have breaking changes and minor changes. But then the, right now the plan is you would require explicit dates. So if you have this notebook, you can never say from latest. You must always say from 1.1.1, 1.1.2. And what we should have is dependency tracking so that you can find out, hey, this library I wrote, 1,000 people are using it, cool. But also, I must tell them that I fixed this so that they can do stuff. And all of these like, is going to happen over time. And a lot of these social conventions that the people using it will develop along with it, while we just provide the technical means that allows them to develop these conventions on top. Yes? Yeah, we need to build social systems on top. I don't think that should be enforced. Well, maybe that could be enforced by a technical system, but I think the order should be the other way around, that people come up with something that works maybe by just, oh yeah, I'll start this wiki page where I list all the things that I vetted with my name on it, and then you provide technical means to make that easier and verifiable rather than the other way around. But yeah, I agree that you need something like that. Otherwise, it's just going to be like, how do I find which thing to use? And yeah, those are all problems that need to be solved. So that's the help stuff. There is a lot of other cool things you can do, like you can access Wikidata query service from here directly. There's a helper function that lets you do that. You can access the page view API from here directly. There is a helper function that lets you do that. And you can also then mix all of them together, right? You can get some data out of the database, some data out of the API, which you can also access, and then mix it with some other things. In very easy ways without having to use different tools for all of them. You can also make really nice graphs, both static and interactive ones. I'm not going to show that right now, but let me maybe, actually no, I can show the. So one of the other cool things about all of this is that I didn't write any of it. I only set it up and provided the integrations with the Wikimedia stuff. All of the code is done by the Jupyter/IPython community. So there's an actual upstream who fixes things and has people working on it. So this is not like one person doing this, right? It's just like this is like the equivalent of setting up a MediaWiki installation in the NASA. They're not maintaining all of it. They're just setting it up and keeping it up. Right, this is TMPNB, which is like Jupyter's temporary setup for people to play with and demo. It doesn't have all the cool features ours has, but it has a demo notebook, which has demo stuff. Oops. So this is, like if I execute this, this is gonna give me, after a lot of warnings, a chart. Right. Yeah. So this is a, I don't think this is an interactive chart. I think this is a non-interactive chart. Right. Scroll down. Oh no, it's an interactive chart. So I can save it, I can move it, and stuff, which I can't do because my hands are all weird shaped. But yeah, so you can do all of those things. All of this is useless if this is all private to just you, but that's not the case at all. So if, like, I will obviously make the UI for this a little better, but if you take the URL of your notebook, and change the PAWS to PAWS-public. Obviously, I'll have to add a UI button for this at some point. Then you get a read-only version of your notebook that you can share with people, and they can then see your code. I will also soon add a fork button here, so you can see someone's read-only version of a notebook, and then you can get a copy of it and make changes yourself and run stuff. And you know, you can also just pass it around, right? Like I can just give this link to someone, like, hey, here are your results. Because if you had a graph, the graph will be there, right? In this, like, I don't think I saved it. Let me save it. Control, save. Right, so, yeah, if I go here, like, all my output is here as well, right? It's not interactive. You can't interact with it. It's a read-only copy. But your output is going to be here. So once you do your work, you can show it to someone, and they can verify the whole thing. You don't have to go, oh, where did the numbers for this come from? Or how did you, what does this mean? Because the code that produced all of it would be there. And you can just reproduce the whole setup yourself. This also has the additional benefit of, like, this is just also like a static file hosting platform right now. So if I go to the, if I go to user colon uvpanda, it lists all the things I have, like all the junk in my home folder. And you can see other things, like, just random .py file is just showing up. So you can use this to, like, earlier the, oops, what happened to the back button? Oops, I don't know. What? Back button doesn't work. Okay. Why is this narrow? Okay. Projectors always suck. You can never get them right. Ah, here it is. Oops. No. Wrong one. Oops. Right, so this is actually on PAWS. I just cloned the annual report website because they wanted me to make some change, and I made the change live. Like, I just cloned it, opened the text editor, made the change, and hit save, and I could send them the URL, and they could see what's going on, and say, oh yeah, that's okay. This is much simpler than setting it up anywhere else. Yeah, eventually we will add ways for people to run actual web services off of this, so you can just write your web service code in a notebook. And then basically say when a URL, when, like, you know, when tools.wmfcollapse.org/something is hit, run this notebook and serve out this. Use this as the web server for that notebook. We'll also add cron tab support, so you can say, oh yeah, this is our report, we want this to run every day, or this is our bot when we want this to run every day, and it'll run automatically, and it'll all be through this GUI. Which would give you almost all of the power of doing the same thing on two labs, but with a lot less headaches. We'll also add daemons, so you can say every time there is an edit on the German Wikipedia that matches this criteria, run this code. And that would run, because we have control over all of this in how it back and run, and you can register it saying this is my criteria, and this is the file you want to run. And because we will have publishing and versioning, you can easily test them. You can say, like, oh yeah, run version 14 of my code when this event happens, and version 15. And then you can say, okay, yeah, my changes work fine. And then you can just, you know, like, okay, go on. Let's ignore 14 now. Let's run all on the 15. While right now, you'll have to use Git. Git is amazing, but it's also quite painful. You have a fairly large learning curve for it. And while I highly recommend learning it, if you're going to do, like, a lot of development, I think there is a large amount of people for whom, like, in the same way, all of the things you could do with MediaWiki, you could have done with LaTeX, but nobody did because it's a pain in the ass. So I think, or at least I would like to think that this is all vaguely similar in the long term. So yeah, so that's all I have. You can do most of those things except the importing bits, which will happen hopefully in the next couple of weeks once we have versioning set up. You can run bots already. You can use the notebook to write your own bots, because PyWikiBot is just a Python library, right? So if you want to write your own bot, it's very trivial. You can just, like, there's lots of PyWikiBot documentation. And because this is just Python, you don't have to learn anything new. You just follow the PyWikiBot documentation and do that with this this interface. Yes?
I have a
Okay, so the question is there a list of Python modules available in PAWS, or can you install whatever you want? So the answer is yes and yes. You can install whatever you want. This is running inside a virtual environment, so you can install your own libraries. But there is also a large list of libraries that is already pre-installed. If you run pip freeze, it'll tell you the list of libraries and their versions. Pip freeze. It's a fairly long list. So NumPy, SciPy, MediaWiki API helpers, MediaWiki dump helpers, PyWikiBot, ways for calculating MediaWiki diffs, parsing, like a library for parsing a talk page, accessing the database. There's like a bunch of them. There's a helper for Wikidata query service, blah, blah, blah. And you can also install your own. And that's also true for R. If you're an R user, you can also install your own R packages. Yes. Yeah, so you do have access to the, refresh. Where's my mouse? Here's my mouse. Yeah, you have access to the dumps. So whatever is available in the public datasets directory on Toolabs is available here. But of course, yeah, I agree, you need to put more. There is mechanisms for adding more data into this. We have a statistics mount and a datasets mount. So whatever data gets pushed onto there, it comes up here. But then someone would need to actually prepare the data and push it. But yeah, right now you have, you know, like all the public dumps. Yeah, so this has the page counts that is Harley page counts. I don't know if it's still being updated. You should ask the analytics team. They probably know better. And then the public is, you know, your Wikidata dumps, your English Wiki dumps, blah, blah, blah. So yeah, and we should, yeah, I agree, we should add more data sets. Just. Yeah. Yes. Okay. So the question is, how does the mix of private and public data work? So this is public by default. Everything you create is instantly available on the public version, unless the folder or file name starts with a dot, in which case it's forbidden. So if you want to have private data, you can just have a folder that or directory or file that starts with a dot. Put your files in there, then it's only accessible to you and the admins. So if you want to, for example, have a list of users and you want the user list exactly to be private, then you just have a folder called .userList. Put your actual stuff in there, and then your code can read that. And then, you know, then you just make sure that you don't like emit it in your analysis. But if you want to just do a completely private analysis, you can always just keep your notebook itself inside that folder with a name that starts with dot. And then when you're happy with that it's fine, you can move it out into somewhere else. Yeah, I think this is simple enough, but we also want to encourage people to be public from the beginning, while also being aware that, yes, there are definitely cases where you want to be private. And so, yeah, I think this is good enough of a system to work just now. Yeah, they're also all licensed by default. Which is, I'll say that now, that's not actually true yet, but you should treat it like it's true. So they'll probably have Apache 2 license set to the default, because unlicensed code is a nightmare. Yeah. Anything else? Have people been having problems getting on? Has people been able to get on? It works fine. Okay. Nobody run into any errors? Wow, that's amazing. Usually there's at least a few people who can't log in. Cool. Questions, thoughts, things that they would like to see in this? Yes.
I have a question. I think it's more about notebooks in general. Mm-hmm. I touched on a little bit when we talked about creating different files that you can reference from other files.
Mm-hmm. So right now, that is not a well-solved problem. One approach to that is, so you can write lots of plugins for the notebooks very easily. So one suggested approach to that is on each save, the notebook runs pip freeze, gets the list of packages that you have and then adds it to the notebook metadata. So notebook files are JSON files with lots of space for putting metadata in. So that's one option where you just basically like automatically, you know, like pip freeze, pipe it into the metadata field, and then every time it runs, you just ensure that all of those are installed. But yeah, that's just like one easy option, which of course has problems because there'll be lots of things installed that you're not using. But yeah, we don't really have a real solution to that. It's pretty much the same as .py files. Like .ipnb files can be treated exactly like .py files with an import hook that we've written. So you could use all the methods you would use for a normal Python project. So you can have a requirements.txt file, you can have a setup.py file, and it would work like a normal Python project. So you could do that, but we would definitely want to have something that's more notebook native in the future. You should use what, sorry? Yeah, you can just use that. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, right, I agree. Yeah, yeah, you should never build your own thing, I agree. It's just a question of like, do you have people explicitly do that, or do you implicitly do that for them? So one other popular approach, so the other thing you can do with notebooks is you can execute commands, like on the shell. So I can, if you start things with a question mark, you can do this. So a lot of times if you want to make sure specific libraries are installed, you can just do this in the beginning of your file, which is exclamation mark, pip install. What do I install? I will, MW client for some reason. Right, and then I execute it, and then it actually runs it, and then it installs it. So if you put this in the beginning of your notebook, then you can be sure that it'll try to install it because people will run it from top to bottom. And then you can pin your versions, do all that stuff. But this is also very explicit because you're literally putting it in the notebook code. So that's another way to manage it. Yes. Yes, there are multiple ways. There is a notebook diff utility that does JSON diffs, but gives you proper code diffs. It just reads the JSON files and gives you diffs. But the easiest way probably is just convert these into .py files and then do diffs like a normal person. So you can enable a plugin that saves a .py version of your IPNB files every time you save. So a lot of people who use Git use that, and they just check in both the files, but they use the .py files for diffs instead of the other stuff. And in the public read-only version you saw, one of the things that I don't think I've implemented yet, but is you can add question mark action equals to code or format equals to code, and it'll download you, it'll give you a copy of just your code in like a plain text format without the JSON stuff. So you can use that to download a .py file and then do your diffs there. If you want. Yeah. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Anyone else? We have time left, I think. Yeah, we have like 10 minutes left. Sorry? Yes, right now if you have been blocked, you can log in and use it until you're a dick to someone, and then we will block you from this too. But yes. That is. There are admin users who have extra rights. I'm an admin user, nobody else is right now. So we can access your servers. We can access your notebook. We can see what you're seeing. And we can remove you from the system. We can put a block on you and a bunch of other stuff. Yeah. Yeah, so there is an admin mechanism. We have some anti-abuse stuff. But all of that is just basically like tell the admin right now. But yeah, we have capabilities there. And these are all running in containers that have a 2 gig memory limit for each user. So you can use up to 2 gigs. The CPU, I think we guarantee you like something like 1/3 of a CPU core. But if not, if other people aren't using it, you can use up to 4 cores. So depending on how loaded the system is, blah, blah, blah. And we have a total of 15 nodes for running this. This is running on the Kubernetes system, which is what two labs itself is moving to. This is actually running on two labs, by the way. This is the new Kubernetes system that is replacing the grid engine system that's old. And we started building this, or I started building this, primarily to test that out. And then eventually, oh yeah, this is useful by itself. So yeah, this is running on two labs, and we'll keep increasing capacity as people use it. Anything more? No? OK. So there's a fabricator project called PAWS. So feel free to file bug requests, not bug, feature requests, bug reports, and just general like whatever things in there. The URL structure for the public version, like the read-only version, is stable. You can depend on that right now. And we will eventually have, like one of the things that Wikitext has and Wiki has that this doesn't have is the ability to edit other people's stuff. Or like the fact that right now everything is user namespaced, like the URL structure has user colon stuff to match that. And we should eventually find a way to have main space stuff that multiple people can edit. But that's more difficult here because it's execution rather than just publishing. So yeah, like right now two people cannot collaborate. You can collaborate by basically like forking and then sending people like you fork from me, I fork from you, and then keep doing that. But that's not great fun. You can use Git. The terminal has Git installed. So if you want to just use Git, you can just use Git. Like set up a repository in Fabricator or Git or GitHub or wherever you want, and then just use Git to collaborate. And that just works fine. We just don't have any Google Docs style collaboration set up yet. I think that's all I had to say. If you also want to hack on it, there is a lot of cool stuff to hack on this, from building like libraries for people to use to just, you know, like building wrappers. Like there are like cool things you can do by just building like a Wikidata query service wrapper that's better than the one I have, or page view wrappers, or just producing more data sets that are set up in here and whatnot. Yes. Oh, what? Git clone should work. Copy paste doesn't work. But if you just do git clone, it works. And if you want to push things back.
Again, pushing is back to,
yeah, it is just like regular. The one difference is that, of course, you need to authenticate yourself to GitHub in some form. So GitHub has one-time tokens, not one-time tokens. It has authentication tokens that you can use. So you go into your preferences and get yourself a token, and then you can use that to push instead of your password. Or of course, you can set up an SSH key in here. You can just use SSH key gen and then set up a key. Right, yeah, so that's already possible. You can totally do that right now. You don't need to wait for us. But I think that is still, like, you should, collaboration shouldn't require GitHub, right? Like, people who are used to Git on the terminal can already do that. But I think we should eventually have a collaboration model that works for everyone else as well. Yeah. You, the question is, can you open Python files in notebooks? And no, you can't. Yeah. You can copy paste them. You can just copy the Python file into one cell in the notebook, and that's kind of the same. Not quite, but close enough. Timo, you had something? Okay. Oh, right, yeah, if you clone something, you can't edit it as a notebook. But then you can edit it on a text file. But usually, yeah, if you're cloning something, you can just put the notebooks into the clone and then work on those. Yes? It pops up an annoying dialogue saying, like, hey, the file has changed on disk. What do you want to do? Which I think is fair enough. Yeah. Like bug one. there is a page on Wikitech, but I think it's incredibly outdated. I think the closest we have to good documentation is the PyWikibot manual, the link you saw when you opened the terminal. I agree that's the thing I should fix. I'll try to get that sorted over the next few days. Yeah. Right. But there's no good way for people to learn about it right now. Yes. That sucks. I think, okay, 5 more minutes and we're out of time. We're not out of time, but here almost. I don't know who's doing next, but I don't think there's anything next here actually. So, are we done? Okay.